Well, I became a member of the Royal Academy in 2006. And as a member of the Royal Academy, one thing that you realise as soon as you become a member is that the Academy runs through its membership. And a detailing of that is that every summer exhibition has a hanging committee made up of its members. And I, in 2009, was invited to be a member of the hanging committee. The title of that year's summer exhibition was Making Space. And I was offered two rooms. One I shared with Eileen Cooper, Gallery 9, which was for photography. And they said, if you would like to hang Gallery 10. Well, Gallery 10 was always the last room. It's a slightly odd room in that it doesn't really benefit from direct sunlight for all time. And therefore, it's a rather sort of, not dark space, but it's a slightly difficult space. It's also traditionally the exit, and I wanted to somehow change that. So Gallery 9 made sense. Eileen and I chatted about it and what we thought we might do for photography. And then Gallery 10, I went away thinking, I think this must have been over the Christmas, thinking about what it was I wanted to do. And I came back with the idea titled Kino, Kino, and I wanted to put together a cinema, albeit with video, so that's slightly odd. And the idea was to invite a number of artists that work with that contemporary practice of moving image. It was a very broad thought in that I thought in any way possible, but then I realised there would be difficulties with that. It was far simpler to have one beamer, one screen, and a number of artists all collated onto one system, like a DVD or stick. And then that would just work on rotation. And people would enter the room, there'd be five seats in the room, you'd sit down and you would view the films. It was a very unconventional thought for the Academy to analyse and consider. It had never been done before. I think there'd been moments of perhaps monitors in spaces, but there'd never been anyone actually come forward and say, we're going to make a cinema room, a film room, and look at this. It wasn't new technology, but look at this practice that really didn't have a membership representative. I can't think in 2009 who was known as a member as a classic filmmaker. I mean, subsequent to that, of course, Tacita Dean, etc., Gillian Wearing. But so I spoke about the idea to Edith Devaney, who was obviously very sympathetic about it. It went to various other sources. And I started to explain that I didn't want just to project on the wall. Making Space was the title, as I said, for that year. That was the title of the summer show. And I thought, I'm going to make a space for film. I'm going to do something unconventional in that space. First of all, to attract attention to the films and to the subject of film, and also to present a sort of sense of non-conformity that had existed in, that might be the way these people are seen. And they are non-conformists, let's say, with the old traditional idea of the Royal Academy of painting and sculpture and print. You know, this was something possibly new for the year. Let's see how we can deal with it. So this unconformist idea was to actually bring my own architecture into the room, albeit a theatrical fake. It wasn't, hacked out of a building and brought in on a very odd shaped lorry. It was a piece of architecture that I designed. It was an interior, but it was a section that appeared to be torn from another space, another place. It was domestic because it included a skirting board. It was a white wall, but it was certainly brutalist. It was ruptured and torn out of another and placed in that space as a dramatic moment to talk about nonconformity of the space, and to have a big idea, to represent big ideas in film, I suppose. So what I did end up doing is fabricating myself in the space this brutalist section of architecture on which to project on. I suppose the interesting thing about film is the fact it's this sort of ephemeral material. You know, it's a mixture of light and sound. You know, both those you can't pick up as a sculptor. But they're on a wall. So that's the physical thing for me. So the wall was the important element for me to design. I felt I just didn't want to, you know, use Gallery 10. That's too easy. I wanted to take this ephemeral quality, light, you know, and sound, and somehow put it onto a wall. And I came up with this model, which in a way is great, because when I made it out of excitement to try and understand the concept. And the model comprises Gallery 10, which is that, and what I wanted to insert into Gallery 10. And with these models, sometimes I make models to understand an idea as a sculptor, and sometimes I make models in order to allow engineers to understand, or for funders to understand. These things are incredibly democratic. By that, what I mean is I don't design in the virtual world. I have done, and I've done that with friends and associates, and particularly engineer friends of mine who have helped me out on works. But with these things, I can go along to an engineer, let's say, and I can sort of put that down, and we can all tamper with the model. Now, the thing about this, you have to understand, is this is the way in. The first thing to do for your audience entering, of course, is not to give too much away. So there's got to be a wall that sort of goes in here, which is, again, a fragment of wall. Why does it have to have all its edges square? It could look as if it's been wrenched away from somewhere and put into, dare I say, the gallery. So this, in the gallery, this is very acceptable, these ideas. So that would have sat here. So as you go in, you still haven't seen the environment within. You can hear it, it's dark, it's welcoming you. You read the number of names, there's 17 artists here, male, female, filmmakers. And as you come in round the corner, this represents the 10 feet by 7 foot frame in which the films were projected. And this happens to be a screen. And it would stand like that, as if it had been torn from a building. These are joists out of the first floor. This is the stud wall. This is another floor up here. This is telling us this has been wrenched out of some Victorian building somewhere and placed down in here. And I think it went something like that. So if I just now take away our entrance, you get an idea of what I did. I put in that derelict bit that's got this beautiful calculated description here for our audience. And then you come in, there were the 5 seats here, and you've got this startling bit of grandiose architecture that's overpowering the room, and this beautiful bit of moving image. Gravity is lost here. This thing is kind of all skew-whiff, rather like a beached tanker on, you know, run up on the beach through a storm. And then you've got the beautiful framing of the film within this rather chaotic architectural lump. And of course, at the end of the show, you know, the program changes, everything gets taken apart, the event is over, let's say. And, you know, what's left? Well, there's memory, the films are returned, the films are obviously owned. But what you do have is you have this kind of stuff, and I've got tons of this sort of stuff laying around. And I spoke with Mark, who's up here with the archive at the Royal Academy, and it was quite obvious that this should be part of the archive. It's as a little bit of memorabilia as to what took place. You know, this was the kind of the very, very first thought. It's rather like the first scribble going down for any idea. You know, what do you do with that? Well, sometimes those first moments are priceless.
There's too many grey faces facing me.
what I liked about it, it was cold calling. You could go in and go, wow, I didn't realise this. And then that thing where you sit down, you might catch a film that probably won't hold you. I don't know. And so you could get up and go away. But you could come back and you would either catch that one again or you catch something else. You know, if you stuck it out, it wasn't difficult, but it was quite lengthy, you know, 17 by 5, do the maths. You could sit through the whole thing. But that's what you do in the cinema anyway. It's just that you're getting 17 different things. And we had humour, we had dryness, we had extraordinary, we had films that were made with very interesting viewpoints, bird's eye view, that sort of thing. Films close proximity, Sean Dower filming the drummer Steve Noble, you know, where the camera is working like the eye, it's just inquisitive, it's going, wow, look at that, you know, underneath the drums, you know, round his head while he's playing and gurning, you know, it's very, very beautiful. So there was, I hate that thing, you know, something for everyone, but there was definitely variety. The other thing you have to say is it was bloody fun to do.
So I'm definitely saying that phone call's down to you.
In terms of legacy, it is on the map. It flag waved the fact that, you know, we are in the 21st century and so is the Royal Academy with its members. You know, we've got a very strong membership now in 2018. You know, the work's changing as well. The work is in its time. And I think that having things are in their time because of, you know, moments of, you know, people putting down footprints to sort of, you know, we're all there and then someone does something and everyone comes up to that next level. And then we're all doing that. And then someone goes off and does that and everyone moves again. And I think, I suppose in the history of the Royal Academy Summer Exhibition, I'm not taking much praise for it, but I mean, the idea that I did that cinema piece, I think it really made people think, oh yeah, we can do what we want here, you know. And I think other artists have taken on board other interesting ideas. I mean, I was coordinator in 2016, and in a way, having done the cinema piece, it was rather like the gauntlet had been thrown down. How can I go one better than that? I've done my RA show. I decided to put together an exhibition of duos, because like film, duos exist in the art world now, like it or not, but they're damn good. And we now have Gilbert and George as members, as one artist. I think what we want to do at the Royal Academy is keep moving forward. We're doing that with our development here, with linking the buildings. And we're doing that because we're thinking of our audience. We've got to always never forget our audience. We've got to keep giving to them. And if we can give them surprises, newness, very clever concepts about what art should be, could be, is, I think that's where we should be. I think we should be always looking at how we can present something, not just strictly something other, but just something where we can hold our audience and we can focus attention on what's happening currently in the art world today.